Today, it's the greatest story ever told, the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. But is the story true? Examine the historical, archaeological, and biblical evidence that prove the resurrection.
2,000 years ago, death couldn't hold Jesus. And 2,000 years on, death won't hold those of us who die in Christ Jesus.
That's next on Canadian Edition. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Hello and welcome to this Easter edition of Canadian Edition. I'm your host, David Geirdson. For weeks now, we've been preparing for what I believe to be the most important day of the Christian calendar. That day when Jesus comes out of the grave and death is conquered. We've been talking about precious promises as we've been leading up to Easter, and Marian Pointer's my spiritual mother's little precious promise box. And today, I think if she were with us, she's now celebrating this Easter from heaven. I have no idea what Easter is like in heaven, but I'm sure it's triumphant and glorious. I think what she would pull out might be this little verse from Luke 24, verse 6. He is not here, he is risen. That's the promise today that we've been looking forward to, not just these past few weeks, but for generations, ever since the foundation of time. That day when Jesus Christ would come, pay the price on Calvary, but then would rise from the grave to let us know that he lives, and because he lives, we live also. Now, what Jesus is doing right now is he's seated at the right hand of God the Father, making intercession for you. So the fact that the angel promised he is not here, he is risen, means that he is now in a position of authority. And so whatever your prayer burden is, whatever your special need is this day, as we come into this wonderful Easter Sunday celebration, we want to encourage you to give us a call at 877-431-7887 or 416-431-0700. We have some prayer warriors standing by who know that Jesus is risen and is ready to make intercession for you. So give us a call. Well, as we said, it's Easter weekend and Christians around the world are celebrating the most remarkable event in human history, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Over the years, many people have tried to disprove the events of that first Easter. Even a recent documentary claimed to have found a tomb containing the bones of Christ. But as Chris Mitchell reports, the evidence for the resurrection is far greater than any claims made against it.
Jerusalem itself bears witness to the greatest story ever told, the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. 2,000-year-old olive trees still thrive in the Garden of Gethsemane, where Jesus agonized before his death. An ancient Roman road leads from the Kidron Valley up to the house of Caiaphas, the Jewish high priest. Stones from the fortress of Pontius Pilate bear the marks of a Roman soldier's game called King for a Day. The impact of the last days of Jesus Christ and his disciples changed the world when, according to the Bible, Jesus became the Passover lamb to atone for the sins of the world. While some try to undermine the story, many biblical scholars say the life and death of Jesus is a matter of historical record. Daryl Bach, professor of New Testament studies at Dallas Theological Seminary, points to the Jewish historian Josephus.
Josephus, in the book called Antiquities, this is book 18, section 61 to 64, describes briefly the life of Jesus. Now, some of what he says is disputed as to whether it goes back to him, but the part that isn't disputed is that Jesus was crucified by Pontius Pilate, and then it was the Jewish leadership that was responsible for bringing him to crucifixion. And those are the base facts that correlate very nicely with the biblical story.
The biblical story runs through this road called the Via Dolorosa, or as it's known in English, the Way of the Cross. It marks the path where Pontius Pilate sent Jesus to be crucified at Golgotha, the site of the crucifixion. But in addition to Pontius Pilate, there's archaeological evidence of other people involved in the passion of Jesus, like Simon of Cyrene, who carried the cross of Jesus. Claire Fawn is an expert in early Christianity.
Both Simon of Cyrene, the father of Rufus and Alexander, according to the Gospel of Mark, and Caiaphas, who was high priest at the time of Jesus and who oversaw his Jewish trial, are both independently attested by the discovery of each of their bone boxes or ossuaries. Now, it's very interesting to think that when you're looking at this event that happened on one weekend in Jerusalem nearly 2,000 years ago, that three of the people who played significant roles in that and who are recorded in the documentary evidence are also attested to archaeologically.
Beyond archaeology, Father Jerry Murphy O'Connor, who studied the Apostle Paul and the early apostles, believes those closest to Jesus, most who died for the faith, would not have given their lives for a lie.
We can rest our faith on the resurrection of Jesus because that was the belief of his disciples, the ones who knew him, the ones who traveled with him, the one who were the witnesses of the appearances. That meant he was alive. They were the witnesses of the empty tomb, and that meant there was no body. That's why they had to say he is risen from the dead.
I think we also cannot set aside the fact that Paul understands this to be a physical resurrection. He says, if Jesus has not been raised from the dead, then our faith is pointless, it's in vain, and everything that we're doing is futile. I don't think that Paul is talking about some type of visionary spiritual manifestation as the resurrection. He's talking about a literal physical resurrection.
While some might say that our belief in the resurrection relies on faith alone, some scholars believe we have evidence that demands a verdict.
We hear the same thing even from the pagan sources about the story that accompanies Christianity. And what we find today is that these are all being questioned again. But it's great to have things like the ossuary of Caiaphas and of Simon of Cyrene to bear witness to the fact that these stories are not just fabrications, but they really are based upon historical truth.
Ken Trestrail, a guide at Jerusalem's Garden Tomb, says the greatest benefit of the resurrection is what Jesus does for every man's soul.
The moment in time we do business with him, he takes us in his arms. His blood will deal with our sin problem, and he lifts us out of time and plants our feet with his in the heavenlies. Now, here's good news in a day of bad news. 2,000 years ago, death couldn't hold Jesus. And 2,000 years on, death won't hold those of us who die in Christ Jesus.
But perhaps the greatest proof of the resurrection of Jesus Christ lies beyond the old city walls of Jerusalem. It's the testimony of more than 1 billion Christians from every tongue and tribe who testify their lives have been forever changed by the resurrected Jesus. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
You know, we celebrate Easter Sunday as a glorious time in the Christian faith, but the reality is, for those first disciples on that very dark morning when they came to the grave, they expected to see the gravestone in place, and they came to mourn and to try in some way figure out what was going on. They thought Jesus had come as the Messiah. He had been promised for generations, for hundreds of years, but now he was dead in the grave. And when they came, as we said at the top of the program, that wonderful promise, he is not here, he is risen. And that's the distinctive difference of the Christian faith. You know, we respect all of the various world religions. We know people have this inner desire within them to seek truth, but we as Christians believe that there's only one truth, and that's the truth in Jesus Christ, that he is the way, the truth, and the life. The other thing that's distinctive about the Christian faith is that our founder is still alive. All of the other founders of the major world religions have died. They've buried somewhere. Their bones exist somewhere. But for those of us who are Christians, we know that he is not here. He is risen, that he defeated death, that he conquered the evil thing that came into the world because of sin. When Adam and Eve were first created, they were created with the ability to live on for eternity. But sin, their rebellion, brought death into the world. And so Paul would say, in looking at Easter Sunday and the impact that the truth of the resurrection has had upon millions of people across these past 2,000 years, death, where is your sting? Grave, where is your victory? Do you know the resurrected Jesus? Do you know that he has risen and he's alive today and desires to live in you through the presence of his Holy Spirit? If you don't, We want to encourage you to call us, 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700. This could be your resurrection day. You could come out of the grave, out of the death that sin brings, and you could know through faith in Him who has conquered death what it means to have your sins forgiven. All you'd have to do is to say, Lord Jesus Christ, I believe. Forgive me of my sins. 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700. And when you call, we will make some teaching material available to you. You can imagine those disciples that Easter Sunday morning and those women that came to find a body in a grave. It would be a brand new day for them. And the material that we have for you is entitled that, A New Day Awaits You. This could be Resurrection Day for you as you let go of sin, embrace the answer to sin, Jesus Christ, and make the decision to follow Him all the days of your life. He is risen. And because He's risen, you can rise to new life as well. Give us a call. Well, still ahead, she was a stripper and he was a loser. Then they tied the knot.
When he proposed, I couldn't believe it.
Who does she marry? A maniac. A guy who's selfish, got married out of lust, and fixed the food, shut up, take care of me.
See how this couple got an even bigger surprise on Easter Sunday.
Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but his own. Awake, my soul, and sing.
Join the 700 Club, and together we will send this message around the world.
Well, he was a jock with an eye for women, and she was a stripper on the brink of suicide. Even before they got married, John and Debbie Lowe seemed destined for divorce court, and that's exactly where they were headed when they struck an unusual deal.
I just can't believe it. I just can't believe he's just been leading me on this whole time.
Debbie had just found out that the man she loved was married. She was well on her way to getting drunk when she said,
"The next guy that walks through the door is mine."
That's when John Lowe came into the bar.
I said, "Come here, Blondie," and I reached over and grabbed him and kissed him, and that was it.
John and Debbie's wild encounter that night started a relationship between two broken people. Although Debbie grew up in a well-to-do Christian home, she was molested by a family friend when she was only 4 years old. At age 13, she gave her life to Christ. But then during high school, she was raped. Drugs and alcohol became a way to numb the pain of sexual abuse. Thoughts of suicide often crossed her mind.
I would just spend, hours just crying and isolating myself in my room.
Debbie ran away from home when she was 16. To survive, she turned to stripping and then prostitution.
It was partly the money and it was partly just the adoration. Somebody accepted you, somebody wanted you.
As much as she liked the attention, Debbie was still drawn to God. She and another stripper often read the Bible together. John, on the other hand, grew up on the poor side of town. As a teenager, he worked as a money collector for his drug-dealing brother.
That job would entail something like a van pulling up in front of your house, the van door would slide open, four or five guys would step up to that open van door with shotguns and blow the windows right out of your house, shoot your house all to pieces, those shells where that guns were empty, the door would close and we'd drive off.
But John had talent. He won a football scholarship to a college in West Virginia and was offered a chance at a better life. That's when he was jilted by his girlfriend and went to the strip club where he met Debbie.
And I was standing there like, whoa, what was that?
Their passion for each other led to marriage just 5 weeks later. Debbie stopped stripping and devoted herself to John.
When he proposed, I couldn't believe it. You know, that somebody actually wanted to commit, you know, a lifetime to me.
But soon after the marriage, Debbie's excitement diminished. John wasn't exactly the man of her dreams.
Who does she marry? A maniac. A guy that has a temper problem. A guy that doesn't know how to be tender or gentle. A guy that doesn't know how to communicate. A guy who's selfish, got married out of lust, and fixed the food, shut up, take care of me.
3 months into their marriage, Debbie got pregnant. But 7 months later, during a routine examination, the doctor gave them tragic news.
Debbie, I'm so sorry, I cannot hear a heartbeat.
And that was just like, you've got to be kidding me. The baby's dead. I was devastated.
Everybody told me God killed it. So I went up on a mountain in West Virginia and basically told God off, gave him the finger, and said, if that's the way you are, I don't need you.
I was really losing my mind at that point. I mean, it was a complete emotional breakdown.
Debbie searched for something to hold on to. She turned on the 700 Club.
How much more will your father give the Holy Spirit to them and ask him?
They were saying words that seemed to give me some glimmer of hope that started to bring some life back into the possibilities of God having an answer for me.
But John dealt with his pain by putting all of his attention on football and other women. They separated for 2 months. During that time, Debbie needed to know if it was really God's will for them to stay together.
I got my Bible out and I prayed and I asked the Lord, I said, you know, I just need to know. And so the Bible fell open to 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 13, where God speaks to the issue of marriage and said, if the unbelieving husband doesn't choose to depart, then for you not to leave.
But when she went back to give John another chance, he gave her divorce papers.
I was just telling the Lord how much I wanted to, you know, make my marriage work, how much I wanted to live my life, you know, to please him, and that, you know, I would do anything he asked me to do.
Debbie also knew that the only one who could change John was God. She asked John for one last favor, to go to Easter service with her the next morning.
After a while, I looked at her and I thought, I'll get her off my back. So I said to her, okay, Deb, this is the deal. I will go to church with you tomorrow, but you have to leave as soon as church is over with, and you have to promise me you will never come back.
Debbie accepted John's terms, but during the Easter service, John whispered something to Debbie.
I said, if I go down there and do that prayer thing, you're not going to cry, will you? And she said, no. Oh, yeah. So I got ticked off. I was ticked. Here she is in this church. All these people know who I am. And she's crying, but I stepped out of the aisle anyway and walked down the aisle and got down to the front where the pastor was and prayed the prayer of salvation. And so we walked out of church that morning, and instead of my wife leaving, it began a miracle of healing our marriage and healing our lives.
John and Debbie decided to devote themselves completely to Jesus Christ. The drugs, alcohol, and adultery stopped. Through counseling, John and Debbie were able to overcome their past and learn how to live as a loving husband and wife and parents.
He's forgiving and gracious to me. He's given me multiple chances. He never gives up on me, and he's always encouraging me, and he's strong.
There is hope and healing even in the most devastating types of circumstances that couples go through. And to say, you know, from experience, we've been through that and we've come out on the other side in victory. And if God will do it for us, he'll do it for you.
You know, Easter weekend is a glorious weekend for family. People get together. They often go to church, and then they come home for a big meal, and friends and families and aunts and uncles and cousins and second and third cousins all get together. And that's a great thing if your family's together. But Easter can really be a problem if there's a problem in your family, and particularly if there's a problem in your marriage. Now, we mentioned that one of the good news aspects and the distinctive aspects of the Christian faith is that Jesus Christ is alive, and he's intimately connected to each and every one of us who look to him. Hebrews 7:25 is one of my favorite verses. It says that he ever lives to make intercession for you. He's not just resurrected and living for some abstract purpose. The reason he's alive is so that he can make intercession for you. And if your marriage is in trouble this Easter, if for whatever reasons you're on the brink of divorce, you're on the brink of some kind of separation, not sure what you're facing in terms of your family relationship, whatever the pain and the trouble is, know this, that Jesus Christ himself, can you grab this? Jesus Christ himself knows your situation. He understands the distress, the pain, the anger, the fear, the frustration. He even understands some of you who are thinking that the only way out of this relationship is perhaps suicide or perhaps murder. We actually talk to people on the phones who are facing those kinds of extreme reactions. And we want you to know that Jesus knows, and he's intimately concerned, and he's just waiting for you to turn to him and say, Jesus, help us. Because if Jesus doesn't help you, there really isn't much hope for your marriage into the future. And all you have to do is to be willing to reach out to him. What better time to celebrate the resurrection of your marriage than on this Sunday, where we celebrate the resurrection of the one who can fix your marriage for eternity. And if you're prepared to do that, we would love to pray with you and talk with you further. 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700. We have some teaching material. It's called Love and Marriage. It's biblical understandings and biblical passages that speak specifically to the kinds of things Jesus will help you achieve as you turn yourself to him and your marriage over to him. So we encourage you, give us a call, 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700. Let this be a resurrection moment for your marriage relationship as you give us a call. And know this, that the first step in your reconciliation to each other is your reconciliation to God through Jesus Christ. You've got to be right with Jesus to be right with each other. 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700. We'll be back with more on Canadian Edition, so stay with us.
Morning. Sorry, guys. I must have slept through the alarm.
Don't worry. Frank seems to have run out of gas again.
You must have had some weekend.
Oh, you wouldn't believe it if I told you.
Try me.
Well, my wife and I help counsel couples with marital problems.
You're kidding, right? Oh, I barely got my grass cut this weekend.
Well, we help deliver food and blankets to inner-city families.
I guess he had time to feed the hungry in third-world countries, too.
Huh? Yeah, we help.
How'd you manage that?
When we joined the 700 Club. They do those kinds of things all the time.
What did that set you back?
Would you pay for that cup of coffee?
You'll be amazed by what you can do as a member of the 700 Club. Your gift of just 65 cents a day, $20 a month, will help reach the lost for Christ in powerful ways. Call now and join friends who are restoring broken lives with God's love, providing food and clothing to the needy in your community, preaching the gospel to the unreached, and opening churches where there are none. Join the 700 Club and change the world with the change in your pocket.
Well, joining me now is our president of the Canadian Broadcasting Associates, George Woodward. He's risen, George.
He is. He's risen indeed.
And what a wonderful way to begin our week of prayer, yeah, to be able to begin it on Easter Sunday. What's happening this spring with our week of prayer and Christian Broadcasting Associates?
You know, we certainly pray for the needs that come in all year long, right, but especially this week. We as a staff, we get together every day and lay our hands upon those requests that come in.
Hallelujah.
Read them one by one and believe God for every single person.
Amen.
It's a wonderful time when we get to link together in very special ways with those that connect with us. It's wonderful.
Well, it's something about this sense of being fueled in our intercession by the resurrection understanding that Jesus is making intercession as well.
Yeah.
Now, people had an opportunity and have an opportunity to send in prayer,
sure,
requests.
Yeah.
Is it too late? Can
it's
they still send them in?
You can connect with us. Certainly send your prayer requests in. Call us, whatever way they connect, but certainly, we would still be delighted to have them connect with us.
And I think they can actually get to us on the internet, too, through 700club.ca.
That's right.
So that would be another way for you to get your prayer requests and bring them into us. George, one of the things that I know we are so deeply committed to is this daily prayer. We have these prayer warriors standing by on our phones to,
yes,
pray. We try to process calls coming in day and night so that people are prayed for. Mm-hmm. What are we hearing in terms of the prayer requests?
You know,
We continually see God do the miracle things that only he can do time after time after time. And so people connect with us. And I have some prayer requests here, and maybe we can just look at a few of them,
please.
And then maybe we can agree together in prayer about them as well. A man named Herb called from Abbotsford, British Columbia, looking for healing for knee problems. You know, so often everything tends to wear out after a while, but God's more than enough. Jim from Medicine Hat in Alberta. Great little place Medicine Hat is. He called in and said, I need healing for an eye condition, been a long-term condition. But God will intervene, I believe. Irene from Waterloo, Ontario, said healing for an enlarged heart. Now, you know, there's lots of ramifications with that as well,
right,
in the natural. But God's in the business of changing things. And so we'll just believe with her as well. Lady named Shirley from LaSalle, Quebec. And she said, I have high blood pressure. You know, so many people have so many things they're believing God for, but we can connect. And then Vivian from St. John, New Brunswick, she said, family salvation. You know, I know we were talking about families earlier, and you were mentioning about marriages and things. God cares about every detail, every aspect of our life. He is the one that changes circumstances.
Well, you know, our theme coming into this week of prayer, and we actually have a little teaching booklet on this as well, called Growing in God's Love. And that's what we believe. God does love us. He's concerned about us. So, George, lead us in prayer, and let's appropriate the resurrection assurance that God does love us today.
Yeah.
Please pray.
Let's pray together. Father, we just thank you that you do love us. Father, it's not something that we have to ask you for. We recognize you've already provided it.
Yes.
And, Father, I thank you. Along with that provision, you've provided for us to have health and wholeness and strength, family stability, strong marriages, children that serve you. Lord, we thank you that we can put our confidence and trust in you today. For you're the God that answers prayer. You're the God that intervenes in the circumstances of our lives. So, Father, we declare today, along with your word, that you are more than enough for everything that we might face.
Yes,
Father, I thank you for every person that's connected with us, everyone that's watching today, your great love for them and your commitment to be involved in the details of their life. Father, we thank you for this. Now, in Jesus' name, amen.
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 Thank you, George. You know, our theme, as we said, is growing in God's love. We want that to be the goal for you as we begin from this Easter Sunday weekend and move forward into the future. As we go into our week of prayer, we want you to grow in God's love. And he's risen for you this day. That's the good news. And he's not here. He's up there. But you know what else? He can be in here. By receiving Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, that can make a profound difference. 877-431-7887 and 416-431-0700. This teaching material called Growing in God's Love is available to you. If you'll just call us and ask for that, we'd be happy to get it to you. On behalf of George Woodward and all of our team at the Canadian 700 Club, we say one more time, he is risen. He's risen indeed.
Amen.
Amen.
For more information, or if you'd like to help continue the ministry of Canadian Edition, please write to us with your gift today. Our address is CBA, Post Office Box 700, Scarborough, Ontario, M1S4T4. Become a 700 Club partner and write today.